Hello students, welcome back. So we are going to start with the daily current affairs class today. So today you will have the class for 23rd of December 2020, and we are basically following the Hindu newspaper. So you can also refer the Hindu newspaper. All right, so you can read the Hindu newspaper or you can also follow Indian Express. Okay, any one of these newspaper you can follow. Apart from that, this is what we are covering from the daily newspaper context. You can also refer the monthly magazines also, right? The monthly magazines. All right. So the monthly magazine, you can refer your coaching institute monthly magazine that will be published by the coaching institute, or any other, the leading institution magazine, you can also refer. All right. So that will basically cover your leftover portion. Okay, whatever you read basically in the newspaper. So I would suggest you to refer the Hindu newspaper. Apart from that, you can also refer the Indian Express, and you can probably read the editorial part of the Indian Express also. So let's begin with the today's class, that is 23rd of December 2020. All right. So the main news which is flashing on the Hindu newspaper is basically related to the great Indian bustards. All right. So it is basically a word. It is basically a bird. So that is basically the news which is flashing with regard to the conservation of the great Indian bustard. So the news is the Ministry of Environment and the Forest. So short form is MOEF, Environment and Forest and Climate Change. This is the nodal ministry for conservation of environment, right? So the Ministry of Environment Forest, along with the Wildlife Conservation Society, right, has come up with a unique initiative of a firefly word diverter, right, for overhead power lines in the area where the great Indian bustard population are found in the wild, right? So you must understand there are certain reasons for the death of the great Indian bustard, right? For example, the great Indian bustards are dying, or the deaths are dying because of lot of reasons. For example, there are reasons like natural reasons also. Like there are regions which are man-made, Such regions are called anthropogenic regions. All right, which are basically generated because of the human intervention. Right, now the human intervention here is that you have the power lines which are basically carrying the electricity from one place to the another place. Now what happens is, if those words basically comes into the contact of these power lines, that may call basically, that may cause their death. All right. And they also fragment the habitat of the great Indian bustard. So in that regard, the government or the Ministry of Environment and Forest is come up with a unique initiative of the firefly word diverter, right? So that will basically divert the bustards, which is coming into the contact of the overhead power lines, which is basically carrying the electricity from one place to the another place, right? This all initiatives are basically, right, so that the great Indian bustard population can be stopped. The decline of the population of the great Indian bustard can be stopped, because now you must understand the great Indian bustard is one of the most critically threatened species in the country, right? So you must understand, as of now, there are less than 150 birds just remaining in India. So just you can assume that only 150 great Indian bustards are remaining in India. So it is basically listed by IUCN, International Union for Conservation of the Nature. It is listed by the IUCN Red List as a critically endangered species. So you can think of the status of the great Indian bustard, which is still in the critically endangered state, right? If we do not protect them, if we do not protect from anthropogenic pressure, they may probably get basically, extinct completely from India, right? So in order to conserve their species, in order to make them so that their species can grow over the period of the time, we are basically, putting all such efforts so that their species can be conserved. Right. In 2019 report, which was published by the similar ministry, which is the nodal ministry called Ministry of Environment and the Forest, which basically pointed out the power lines, right? Those power lines you might have seen, right? These power lines basically carry the high voltage transmission lines, right? These high voltage transmission lines basically having the multiple overhead wires, right? And most important, the current threat to the Great Indian Bustard. And because of this current, the many Great Indian Bustards basically have died in the process of moving from one place to the another place. Now, because of this high mortality of these Great Indian Bustard, the Ministry of Environment and Forest have come up with this unique initiative of firefly bird diverter, so that they can divert the incoming Great Indian Bustard towards the power lines or towards the high power lines. Now, these firefly bird diverters, right, which are basically flaps, right? So they will basically flap are installed on the power lines, right? These flaps basically would reflect, right? Are generally the reflectors for the bird species, and birds can spot them from the distance of around say 50 meters. So once the incoming birds are coming towards say at the power lines, once the incoming bird can spot them, so that they can change their path to avoid the collision with the power lines. So you can say that it is just in flaps. These flaps would act as a diverter for the birds. Now, once the incoming bird, which is approaching towards the power line, they can easily change their path, or they can divert from their path so that they can avoid such collisions from the power line. So these are basically all sort of a mechanism which are basically going to be installed all along the power line, so that their collision with those high voltage power lines can be stopped, and their mortality through this process can also be stopped. Right now, this firefly detectors which are there have been already installed along two stretches of approximately 6.5 kilometers selected between the Chacha to Dholia villages in the Pokhran Tehsil of Rajasthan. So this point is very, very important from the objective question point of view, that such firefly detectors which are used to divert right the Great Indian Bustard from their movement right towards approaching the high power lines or high power cable lines, so that they can avoid the collisions from this high voltage power lines. All right, so now this the firefly detectors have already been installed in the Pokhran Tehsil of Rajasthan, right? So you can say that around 6.5 kilometers of such stretch have been selected, and already the firefly detectors have already been installed on the power lines. These diverters are also called fireflies because they look like fireflies from the distance, right? Because they basically shine on the power lines in the night. In the night also, when these birds move, once they spot these shining type of creature or shining type of thing on the power cable, they may probably change their path, or they may divert their path from the approaching angle towards the another angle. All right, so that they can avoid the collision. So this is the news which is flashing on the Hindu newspapers. You can again read that one. The Great Indian Bustard is a bird, right, which is basically currently is in the critically endangered species according to the IUCN red list, right? In India, approximately 150 birds have been left over, right? So the condition or the state of those birds are very, very pathetic. They are already in the critically endangered state, right? So the Ministry of Environment and the Forest have come up with a unique initiative of protection of those critically endangered species from the anthropogenic factors, right? One such anthropogenic factor is the high tension power lines, right, which are running from the one place to the another place. And this high transmission voltage lines, you must understand, when these birds come into the contact, there is a threat of the current to the Great Indian Bustard, and they may die also. So in that process, the population of the Great Indian Bustard have been continuously been declining by one such regions through that the current from high voltage power lines. So the government of India or the Ministry of Environment and the Forest is planning to install the unique initiative which is called firefly bird diverter. So firefly means it will shine in the night also, right? And bird diverter means it can divert the birds, especially the Great Indian Bustard, from approaching towards the high voltage power lines. All right. So this is what the news in the today's headlines. All right. Let's understand the new news. F-18 Super Hornet fighter jets. Okay. Everyone understand F-18 Super Hornet fighter jets. So you must understand, right? The Boeing, which is the company which announced, right? Boeing is the major, you know, the civil aviation company which basically produce, you know, the fighter jets as well as the passenger jets. All right. So Boeing announced the successful demonstration of compatibility of F-18 Super Hornet fighter jets with Indian Navy's aircraft carrier. Okay, as a part of its pitch for the Navy's fighter procurement. So you must understand there are specialized ships which are called the aircraft carriers, which can carry the aircrafts on the Navy ship itself, right? So such ships are called aircraft carriers because they can carry the aircraft on such aircraft carriers. The aircraft can basically land and they basically can take off, right? So such demonstration of F-18 Super Hornet fighter jets on the Indian Navy's, you know, the aircraft carrier have been successfully demonstrated by the Boeing company, right? So that it can basically ascertain the Navy's requirement of procurement of fighter jets. Now, these demonstrations, which was done, right, with the help of the Boeing, was held in the coordination of US Navy, right? Because Boeing is basically a US company, right? So the government of India, along with the government of USA, right? So the nodal ministry, you can say that, the Ministry of Defense. So under the Indian Navy, under the US Navy, both have been collaborating to demonstrate such compatibility of F-18 fighter jets on the Indian Navy aircraft carrier so that it can probably land. They can check out the compatibility of such carrier, and such demonstrations were held in the coordination with US Navy on also waste facility at Naval Air Station, that is basically Potosant River in the Maryland, USA. All right, so such demonstration was held, right, on the shore based facility in the US itself, in the Maryland. Such demonstrations show that F-18 Super Hornet would do well with the Indian Navy short takeoff but arrested recovery system. Okay, so it is a one such system where you can basically, right, you can basically shortly run on the runway so that you can easily take off, and you have the arrested recovery. Arrested recovery means you might have seen through the videos through which there is a ring which is basically stretched all along the basically runway. When the aircraft approaches the runway during, you know, landing, this arresting system basically arrests the basically, you know, the tires, or, you know, the back rear the rear gears basically from approaching further. So that is called arrested recovery system, right? So such short takeoff and arrested recovery system, which was installed in the Indian Navy's aircraft carrier, have been successfully tested and have been successfully demonstrated that F-18 Super Hornet fighter jets have been successfully, right, can land and can take off from Indian Navy's aircraft carrier. And that also validate the earlier stimulus studies which done over last 2 years. So you must understand such studies on the feasibility or the compatibility of F-18 Super Hornet fighter jets on the aircraft carrier have already been studied since the last 2 years. Now this compatibility have been tested, right, in the Maryland in the USA, where it can basically take on the Indian Navy short takeoff mechanism and arrested recovery system, which can basically facilitate the landing and the takeoff of fighter jets on the aircraft carrier, on the Indian Navy's aircraft carrier. All right. So as a part of Boeing proposed Buy India for India, you are getting my point. So Buy India for India, a sustainment program, right? The Block 3rd Super Hornet could be serviced in the partnership with Indian Navy as well as the India and US based partners throughout the life cycle of the aircraft. So this is what the project which was proposed, right? So by India for India sustainment program, under which these Super Hornets, which are basically F-18, they will be serviced in the partnership with Indian Navy, right? That will be partnered right throughout the life cycle of the aircraft, right? So that it can basically, you know, help in terms of the strategic relationship between India and the US. All right, let's move to the new news. The Abdul Rahim Khane Khana, okay? You might have heard about this personality, or the most popularly who is known as simply Rahim, right? He's also known as Rahim. His full name is basically Abdul Rahim Khane Khana, right? He was basically a poet. He was basically a poet, right? And he was as a contemporary of the Akbar, who was basically emperor, or who were basically a Mughal emperor. So you can say that he was basically a poet, right? Who basically works during the reign of Akbar. During the reign of Akbar, who was basically a Mughal emperor. Now, let's understand the news which is coming regarding the Abdul Rahim Khane Khana. All right. So first of all, the Rahim Khan's tomb, or simple, the Rahim's tomb was opened to the public after 6 years of restoration work, right? So that tomb basically, which was under restoration because it was wear and tear, and it required certain set of the reconstruction, the restoration work on the tomb. So it was basically, you know, open to the public after 6 years of the restoration tomb. And perhaps such project was the largest conservation project ever taken by any monument of the national importance in India. All right. So the most important point to be noted here in this news is that the Abdul Rahim Khane Khana, who is also known as the Rahim, his tomb was open to the public after 6 years of the restoration. And such restoration are perhaps the largest conservation project ever done by the government for any monument of national importance in India. And this monument is also the monument of national importance. Now let's understand briefly about the Abdul Rahim Khane Khana. Right, this Abdul Rahim Khane Khana, who was basically born in 1556 and he died basically in 1627. So popularly, he was also known as simply Rahim, right? And he was basically a poet who lived in India during the rule of Mughal Emperor Akbar. All right. So during that rule of Mughal Emperor Akbar, he lived in India. And he was basically, or Abdul Rahim Khane Khana was basically a son of Bairam Khan, who was the Akbar's trusted guardian and the mentor. If you have seen the movie called Akbar the Great, in that the first scene in the movie itself shown the Bairam Khan. So the Bairam Khan basically is a trusted guardian and the mentor of Akbar, right? So he was the son of the Bairam Khan, who was a guardian and the mentor of the Mughal Emperor Akbar itself. And he was one of the 9 important ministers, right? Or the Diwans in his courts, and popularly known as Navratna, right? So Navratna was basically popularly known as the 9 important ministers or the Diwans in the court of Akbar. And Abdul Rahim Khane Khana is also one such, you know, one such minister or one such jewel among 8 such important ministers in the court of Akbar, in the court of Akbar. So this is what the news is coming. So news is basically related to the work which was undergoing for restoration of such tomb have been now this tomb have been opened to the public for the public viewing purpose. All right. Now, the Rahim or Abdul Rahim Khane Khana, who is also known for his Hindi dohas or couplets and his book on astrology. So the most important point they can ask you basically related to the Abdul Rahim Khane Khana, who is known for the Hindi dohas, okay, and he also written one book on astrology, right? Books on astrology itself. So apart from writing various dohas, the Rahim translated the Babur's memories, right? that is called Bavarnama, from Chagatai language to the Persian language. All right. So the Babur was also emperor, right? So he basically translated the Bavarnama, which was the Babur's memoir, into the Persian language, and which will be useful for the administrative purpose. So this is also one of the important points you should note down. It can be asked in the objective type question, that who translate the Bavarnama from Chagatai language into the Persian language. So that is basically the Abdul Rahim Khane Khanna, who is basically a poet in the Akbar's court. And who is basically Rahim? He was the son of the Bairam Khan. Who was the Bairam Khan? The Bairam Khan was basically guardian and the mentor of Akbar himself. So he is very close to the Akbar. And the Rahim or Abdul Rahim Khane Khanna, he has the excellent command over the Sanskrit language, right? In the Sanskrit, he also wrote two books on the astrology, right? His two books on the astrology is known as Kheta Khautukam, and the second is Dwatri Mishadi Govali, right? So these are the two books which were written by the Abdul Rahim Khane Khanna in the Sanskrit, because he was having the greater command on the Sanskrit language, right? So he has probably written these two books on the astrology. And the village of Khan Khana, which is the named after him, is located in the basically Nawan Shah district of Punjab. So this is also most important point, that a village which is basically named after the Abdul Rahim Khane Khanna, right, which is also located in the district of Punjab. In the district of Punjab, the district is Nawanshahr district of Punjab. So this is what the news which is flashing in the Hindu newspaper. So I would again read the news. You can refer that the Abdul Rahim Khane Khanna was basically a poet. He was popularly known as the Rahim, right? And his tomb, which was opened to the public after 6 years of the restoration work, with the help of Archaeological Society of India, right, which have been opened for the public. Now, this restoration work was one such largest restoration work ever undertaken for any monument of public importance in India. All right, this Abdul Rahim Khane Khanna was basically a poet in the Akbar's court, and he was born in 1556. All right, and he died in 1627. Rahim was basically lived in India during the rule of Mughal Emperor Akbar, and he was the son. I'm talking about the Rahim. The Rahim was the son of Bairam Khan, and Bairam Khan was basically a mentor of the Emperor Akbar itself. All right, and the Rahim was among 9 important ministers, right, in the court of Emperor Akbar itself. So he was also among the Navratnas, or 9 important ministers, or the Diwan in the court of Akbar. And you must understand, he has the excellent command. He has the excellent command on Hindi and the Sanskrit both. So he is very famous, or he is known for his Hindi dohes or couplets. And he also written the books on astrology. And he has the excellent command on the Sanskrit language itself. So he wrote 2 books on the astrology. That was Kheta Khautukam and Dwatri Mishadi Ogavali. Right? These are the 2 books which have been written by the Rahim, Abdul Rahim Khane Khanna. And also, he was also known for the translation of the Bavarnama, who is also known as the Babur's memoir. Right? He was the person who translated this Bavarnama from Chagatai language to the Persian language. And one village also named after the Abdul Rahim Khane Khanna, who is also named as the Khan Khana. The village name is Khan Khana, and it is located in the Nawanshahr district of Punjab. All right. So this is what is some of the important points to be taken from the person who is known as Abdul Rahim Khane Khanna. All right. Let's move to the new news. The next news is Ustad Debu. So what is the news regarding the Ustad Debu? The Ustad Debu died in Mumbai at the age of 73, right? After being diagnosed a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, right? You must understand who was Ustad Debu. The Ustad Debu was a dancer and a choreographer, right? Who was also known for his, you know, the choreography and the dancing. And he died in the Mumbai after being diagnosis of the lymphoma. Now, he's considered as a pioneer of modern dance in India. So you might have heard about the Ustad Debu, all right. And you must understand, he was introduced to the Kathak, the same, you know, the dance by the Guru Prahlad Das when he was only 6. So you must understand, he was introduced to the Kathak, right, when he was just six year old by a guru who is also called a Guru Prahlad Das. And later, the Ustad Debu learned the Kathakli under the separate guru or the different guru, which is also known as Guru E. Krishna Panikkar. And the Ustad Debu basically mastered the modern dance techniques, right, of Martha Graham and Jose Lemon in the London and the New York, right? So you must understand, he basically learned such modern dance techniques in London and New York, right, in the later period of the time. And you must understand, he also collaborated with several international artists, right? Several international artists. Also, it is also new for you, right? The Pina Bausch, Alison Baker, Chase, and Pink Floyd. These are basically the international artists which was associated with Ustad Debu. So you can also read a bit about them from the news, from basically the Wikipedia. You can refer or you can just put it down, Pina Bausch, how it is related to the Ustad Debu, the Alison Baker, Chase, and Pink Floyd. You can also read a one or two sentences from from the Wikipedia. And he was also awarded the Sangeet Natak Academy Award in 1996 and Padam Shri in 2007. All right. So he was very famous for his modern dance techniques, right? And he was also known for the contemporary dancer, choreographer, right? And he was recently died in the Mumbai at the age of 73. And he was considered a pioneer of modern dance in India. And he learned basically the Kathak in the initial phase of his age at the age of 6. He was introduced to the Kathak by Guru Prahlad Das. And later he learned the Kathakli under the Guru Krishna Panikkar. And he mastered such modern dance techniques, in basically London and the New York. And thereafter he was associating with international artists also. Right, and he was awarded the Sangeet Natak Academy Award as well as the Padam Shri Award in 2007. So it is about the news of Ustad Debu. Okay, all right. So the breakdancing, right? So breakdancing was basically incorporated in the official Olympic sport, right? So it was incorporated after the pursuit of International Olympic Committee, right? Which included basically the urban events to lure some of the youngsters, right, into the medal events program at 2024, the Paris Games. So the Olympic Games, which are going to be held in 2024, right, and the Paris, right, so which is basically included in the official Olympic sport. Now you must understand, the breakdancing, which was proposed by the Paris organizers itself around almost 2 years ago, right? After they have been trialing this game at 2018 Youth Olympics in the Buenos Aires. So after they have been doing the positive trials of incorporating such games at the Buenos Aires, they have been also incorporated into the International Olympic Cup, into the Olympic sport in 2024 itself, right? Which was the work behind of the Paris organizers, which want this game to be included into the 2024 Paris Games, which are going to be held in the France, in the Paris, in the France. All right. This is the news. The next news is WHO's 2019 Global Health Estimate. Okay, so let's understand how the global health estimates have been held by World Health Organizations. All right, so everybody knows about the World Health Organization. It is an international organization which is concerning with the world health and related parameters, right? So the WHO's 2019, the global health estimate, which means it basically estimated the health of the global population, which was recently released in a non-communicable disease, now make up 7 of the world top 10 cause of death, right? So in basically in its estimates, it says that the non-communicable disease, now make up 7 of the world top 10 causes of the death, right? Which is now increased, right, from 4 of the 10 leading cause of the death in 2000, right? So you can say that now this non-communicable diseases now making up the 7 of the world top 10 causes of the death. That means the top 10 deaths causes, which out of top 10, the 7 makes the non-communicable diseases of the global death of the global population, right? This new data covers the period from 2000 to 2019. So almost 21 years, they have been covering this data. Now, this non-communicable disease have now become the almost 7 of the world 10 causes of the death among the global population in the world. So among that non-communicable diseases, the heart disease remains the leading cause of death. So heart-related complications, heart attack, and heart-related diseases remains the leading cause of the death at the global level for last 20 years. Because the heart-related elements or the diseases are called because of the lifestyle diseases, right? It causes either the smoke, or because of the lifestyle changes, the people life have become so much sedentary, and because of the climatic change and your pollution, right, in the cities, which has led to the health-related defects, right? Apart from the fooding habits and your lifestyle habits is also one of the responsible causes of the heart-related diseases. Now, the heart diseases now represents the 16% of the total deaths from all causes. All right. So, for example, if you have 100 causes, right? If you have 100% deaths, right, from every such causes, right? The heart-related causes or heart-related diseases estimates around 16% of such deaths from all causes, right? And number of the deaths from heart diseases increased by more than 2 million since 2000 to nearly 9 million in 2019. So you can say that it has increased by more than 2 million when you compare, right, when you compare the years between 2000 and 2019. So it has increased to nearly 9 million deaths in the world because of heart-related problems. So heart-related problems is the leading cause of death among the world population, according to WHO's 2019 Global Health Estimate. And this all non-communicable diseases, right, have now become 7 out of world 10 most causes of the death among the global population, which has increased from 4 out of 10 leading causes of the death in 2000. And now the heart-related deaths, right, is the largest cause of, or the leading cause of death among the global population, now which has increased by more than 2 million if we compare the data from 2000 to 2019. All right. The next one is diabetes and dementia. Diabetes and dementia are also among the world top 10 causes of the death. Okay, so apart from the heart-related diseases, the diabetic and the dementia is also the world top 10 causes of the disease. Now, more communicable diseases are now causing deaths worldwide. This is also another aspect from the WHO's estimate, right? So now non-communicable diseases are now causing more and more deaths worldwide. And there is global decline in the deaths, which is causing because of the communicable disease, right? So the deaths or the percentage of the deaths caused by the communicable diseases are now declining among the world population. But the percentage of the deaths right, as a proportion of the total deaths have now increasing, right, when we say from non-communicable diseases. So this is also alarming news. And this is also one which is very much alarming because of the lifestyle, diseases, and because of such, you know, the fooding habits and pollution, which has also caused the heart-related ailments. And however, the major challenge basically lies in low and middle income countries, because in the low and middle income countries, there are a lot of challenges. The first challenge is the resources unavailability, right? There is no such advanced medical facilities in the low and middle income countries, and people are very poor. They cannot afford, you know, the quality healthcare facilities which are there in the some of the developed, leading developed countries, as well as the few of the developing spots. For example, Chennai in India is famous for the medical tourism, right, where almost all type of, you know, the major operations have been successfully conducted in the Chennai, right, at very reasonable cost. And people used to come to operate, you know, in the southern India, because they are very famous for such operations, and you know, with the similar expenses or with very cheap expenses, you can get operated in, basically, in the southern India, especially the Chennai. All right. So the medical tourism and medical facilities which are lying in India are much advanced, right? But it is at the reasonable cost when you compare with some of the developed countries. It is very costly in the developed countries like USA, Britain, and etc. All right. And in 2019, the pneumonia and other lower respiratory infections were the deadliest group of communicable diseases that are found. Right. So among the communicable diseases, according to WHO's the estimate report, which says that in 2019, the pneumonia and the respiratory infections, which are communicable in the nature, are the two deadliest group of the communicable diseases which causes the death, and which together rank fourth leading cause of death. So the first leading cause of the death is the heart related problems or heart related deaths. The second and the third, you know, the leading cause of the death is again non-communicable causes or non-communicable the diseases, which are diabetes and dementia. And the fourth one is the pneumonia and lower respiratory infections, which are basically communicable in the nature, and which cause the fourth largest cause of death among the world population. All right. And the HIV and AIDS, or that is human immunovirus, or the acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, dropped from 8th leading cause of death in 2000 to 19th cause of death in 2019. So you can say that the HIV related deaths and AIDS related deaths have now been falling. The people which is dying from AIDS related ailments have now been declining, when you compare with the absolute number of deaths. Right now, this the leading cause of that, which was 8th one in 2000, now have been declined to 19th spot in 2019, so which is much lower. All right, next is tuberculosis. The tuberculosis is TB, is no longer is global top 10. Now it was at the 7th spot in 2000, in the year 2000. Now it has declined to 13th spot in 2019. And this decline of 7th spot in 2000 to 13th spot in 2019, which shows that there is around 30% reduction in the global deaths. All right, so 30% of the reduction in terms of the death because of the tuberculosis is one of the greatest achievement of the medical science and medical facilities all throughout the world, right? As well as the concentrated effort of the government of the various countries. Now, the estimates further confirm the growing trend of longevity, okay? The people are living longer. So then there is growing trend of longevity. In 2019, the people were living more than 6 years longer than it was in 2000, right? So you can say that in 2019, people lived almost 6 years longer, right? So, and the global average of more than 73 years in 2019 as compared to 67 years in 2000. So this is the latest data which shows that in 2000, the longevity was just 67 years. Now it has increased to the global average to 73 years in 2019. So these are some of the glimpse of the report of WHO. All right. So let's briefly again recap of the report of the WHO. So what I said is that WHO releases this his global its global health estimates report in 2019. Okay, so it has made certain, you know, the observations regarding the deaths, regarding the health parameters. So in this report, the global health or the World Health Organization has estimated that the top 10 causes of the deaths or the diseases which cause you know, deaths among 10 top diseases, right? The seven belongs to the non-communicable diseases. So seven leading causes of the deaths belongs to non-communicable diseases, right? Or you can say that only three such causes of the deaths among top 10 are related to communicable diseases. Now, the most deadliest causes of the death is heart-related diseases, which is causing almost 2 million deaths, right? Which is causing around 9 million deaths in 2019. So you can say that, which has increased to around 2 million when you compare the data from 2000 to 2019. The second most causes of the death is diabetes or dementia, which is the top, which is the word, which is among the world 10 causes of the deaths, right? When you compare with such non-communicable diseases, now the most important sufferers in these non-communicable diseases are basically low and middle income countries because of the paucity of the medical facilities and affordability of such expensive medical facilities in the low and middle income countries. And when you compare with the communicable diseases, it is the pneumonia and the lower respiratory infections are the most deadliest group of communicable diseases, which are ranked at the fourth leading cause of death among the among all causes of the death. All right. And HIV and AIDS, which was at the eighth position, now which has declined to 19th position in 2019. So which shows that the HIV and AIDS related deaths has now been declined to the 19th spot. And the tuberculosis, which is also called TB, right? It is no longer a top 10, the deadliest disease, but it is replaced from 7th place in 2002, 13th spot in 2019. So according to the WHO, there are around 30% reduction in the global health or global death because of the tuberculosis. All right, and the last and most important the observation which was made by the World Health Organization is that the longevity, when you compare the growing trend for the longevity in the world, it has now increased to 73 years global average of the people who is living at 73 years. And this longevity, which was just 67 years in 2000. So that means today people are living more than 6 years longer than what was there in the year 2000. So this is what the trend which is coming and which is reflecting, right, by the data of the World Health Organization. All right. Then next news is India's Workplace Equality Index. What is this India's Workplace Equality Index? So you must understand, India Workplace Equality Index. So this was touted as a country's first comprehensive benchmarking tool for the employers to measure their progress on LGBT, right? That is lesbian, gay, and all sort of things. And inclusion at their workplace was launched. So you must understand, right? Transgender. So you must understand, the India's Workplace Equality Index is basically the first such comprehensive index, right, which is a benchmarking tool to the employers, especially who give the employment to the people, right, to measure their progress in terms of incorporation of the LGBT communities, right, the basically lesbians, gay, transgender, right, at their workplace. Right now you must understand the case of Suri. You might have heard about this activist who is also known as Keshav Suri. Through his non-profit, that is Keshav Suri Foundation, partnered with the Pride Circle and Stonewall UK and FICCI to bring the India's workplace equality index to India INC. So due to this cumulative effort of the Keshav Suri Foundation, along with the partnership of Pride Circle, Stonewall UK and FICCI, these all collaboration has led to the incorporation of the India Workplace Equality Index to the India INC, and its first report, which was published now, which has announced the winners from among 65 countries, 65 companies, right, which shared the data on their diversity, inclusion of the lesbians, gay, you know, the transgender LGBT communities into the basically, you know, the diversification of their, you know, employment, which was given to those communities, right? 21 firms won under gold category, right? And 18 such placed under the silver category, and 13 got bronze category. So you must understand, 65 companies which shared the data with the non-profit organization, which was Keshav Suri Foundation, which was partnered with another organizations among 65 companies which shared the data. The 21 placed under the gold category, and 18 placed under silver, and 13 placed under bronze category. So this is one of the important, you know, the achievement in terms of the incorporation of LGBT communities into the basically into, you know, diversifying of the employing and diversify of the employers, right? How they basically employ the people from diversified, you know, the field, whether they have been incorporating or they are still hesitating of employing, right, the lesbians, the gays, and other transgender community. So this is what is something which is very important, and that should also should be worked out as a proper plan to incorporate those communities, because they have been, you know, left out from the mainstream. Now, because of the Supreme Court, you know, mandate, and because of the Supreme Court judgment, now the government of India is also become a little bit sincere about incorporating of these communities into the basically the diversifying, you know, the workplace. All right. So this is the news which is flashing regarding India Workplace Equality Index. All right. The index which measures the 9 areas. Okay, what are the 9 areas? The policies and the benefits, how the policies have been made, and how the benefits have been permeated to the LGBT communities. Okay, it is all related to the diversification of the employees, whether the incorporation or inclusion of LGBT community have been taken place or not, and employees' life cycle, employee network groups, right? And the allies and the role models, the senior leadership, the monitoring, procurement, community engagement, and additional work. So these are the 9 areas which are basically incorporated in basically the India Workplace Equality Index 2020. All right, fine. Now, extreme weather event hotspot. What is this extreme weather event hotspot? So you must understand, the news which is flashing is that 75% of the districts in India, all right? So you have around, say, 650 districts in India. Roughly among 650 districts, you have 75% of the districts in India is the home to more than 63 crore people, and which are the hotspot of extreme climatic events. Now, these extreme climatic events, you can also classify them as a cyclone. Climatic events is because of the climate change. Extreme means it is in the nature of devastation, which caused so much of devastation, right, to the loss of men and materials, like floods, cyclones, droughts, right, heat, cold wave, right, all such extreme events which have happened, right, happened due to the weather changes. Now this has caused, right, so much of loss to the men and material. Now, this the study which was conducted by the Council on Energy on the environment and the water, or CEEW. The study confirmed that the 75% of the India's districts, right, are the basically hotspot of extreme climatic events. So that means they are vulnerable to such extreme climatic events, and among all 75% of the districts which are home to, or which are more vulnerable to extreme weather events, where such cyclones, floods, drought, heat, cold wave have been occurring are the home of around 64 crore of the population of India. Now, this is the first time that extreme weather event hotspot in the country have been mapped. Now, what is the significance of such mapping? You can say that the significance of mapping is for better planning, for better mitigating such the ill effects or such negative effects of the extreme weather events which occur in certain districts or which may be lying in the coastal areas also. So if we map them, or if we, you know, classify them as a extreme weather event hotspots, right, you can probably can better, you know, use that data to mitigate the ill effects of the extreme weather events from these state, from the districts. Now, the frequency, intensity, unpredictability of these extreme events have risen in recent decades. Okay, so you must understand the frequency and intensity. Frequency means how frequent is the extreme event occur, right? Whether it's occurring in the once in a year, twice in a year, thrice in a year, how intense it was. Intensity is related to the devastation it is causing, right? How intense, how many people died, how many, you know, the houses have been devastated, how many animals killed, and unpredictability, whether you are able to predict the hotspot event or not. So everything has risen in the recent decades. Now, India has witnessed 250 extreme climatic events in the 35 years. Okay, so when you compile the data of such extreme climatic events from 1970 to 2005, right? India witnessed 250 extreme climatic events. All right, and you must understand that it recorded just in 15 years, right? Since the study have been carried out. So in the recent 15 years from 2005 to 2020, India witnessed 310 such weather events. So what this data is signifying? The data is simply signifying that the frequency of such extreme weather events have been increased in the recent years. And you must understand the pace which has increased from 250, which was occurring in 35 years. Now, just in 15 years, that means less than half a time, right? You are occurring almost, you know, 20% more such extreme events than was occurring in 35 years. All right, so this is an alarming that shows that the anthropogenic involvement or anthropogenic cause of the extreme weather events has now increased. Now, this is not the natural, but it is anthropogenic in the nature. The human have greatly involved in, you know, it basically, in such extreme weather in events, because the climatic change, because of greenhouse gases which is liberating in the atmosphere, right? And the human related pollutions, right? Urbanizations related, you know, problems, cutting down of the forest, deforestations, right? The terrestrial movement of the water body pollution, and a lot of other anthropogenic activities has caused so much damage to the environment and the ecology, and which has led to such extreme weather events, and which has led to the climate change. Now, this climate change is impacting throughout the world. All right, so this is what is the news. In the last 50 years, the frequency of the flood events has increased almost 8 times. So you can say that the frequency of the flood now, which has increased to almost 8 times. Now, it is more than 8 times, which is more frequent than it was there, which was there before 50 years back. Now, this event which is associated with the floods now, such as the landslide, okay, the heavy rainfall, the hailstorm, the thunderstorms, the cloudburst, increased by over 20 times. So this is another alarming news, that the frequency of the flood has increased almost 8 times. The events which is associated with the flood, for example, if the flood comes, the landslide is natural occurring, the heavy rainfall, the hailstorms, thunderstorms have been increasing almost 20 times. All right. Now, 6 of India's 8 most flood-prone districts in the last decade is Barpeta, Darang, धेमाजी, गोलपारा, गोलाघाट, शिव सागर आर इन द असम, राइट? सो यू मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड अमोंग द एट मोस्ट फ्लड प्रोन डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स, सिक्स आर एलोन इन द असम इटसेल्फ. सो असम इज मोर वल्नरेबल टुवर्ड्स द फ्लडिंग इवेंट, टुवर्ड्स द फ्लडिंग इवेंट. एंड ईयरली एवरेज ऑफ द ड्रॉट इफेक्टिव डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स हैज इंक्रीज्ड 13 टाइम्स आफ्टर 2005. दिस इज अनदर न्यूज. Okay, so drought affected districts has also increased, and nearly 68% of the districts have faced droughts, drought-like situations in the country. All right, so this is what is something is also alarming in the in our country, which is in the nature of this extreme event which is occurring in India. Okay, when you compare with the drought affected districts or drought affected hotspot district in India, right, the Ahmednagar, which is in the Maharashtra, the Aurangabad, which is in both in the Maharashtra, the Anantapur, which is in Andhra Pradesh, the Chittoor, which is in again in Andhra Pradesh, the Bala, the Bagalkot, which is in basically Karnataka, the Bijapur, again in Karnataka, right? Chikkavalapur, which is in Karnataka, Gulbarga, again Karnataka, and Hassan. These are basically the hot spots or the drought effective districts of basically in India. So these are the hot spots which is related to the drought. Now, the study also found a shift in the pattern of extreme climatic events, such as flood-prone areas becoming the drought-prone areas, okay, and vice versa. Sometime, one area which was flood-prone, now they have become drought-prone. Some area was drought-prone, now the shift has changed to the flood-prone area, right? Why this is happening? This is all is happening because of the climatic change. The climatic change basically because of the driven by anthropogenic regions has causing so much problem. Next is mini Kaziranga. Okay, now you must understand there are the Kaziranga National Park is basically in Assam, and basically the Pabi Tora Wildlife Sanctuary is also in the Assam. Now they are basically the Pabi Tora and the Kaziranga National Park are known for one horn rhino source population, right, which is the highest in our country. Now too many cattle which are basically grazed on the grass are robbing one horn rhinos which are staying in the basically Pabi Tora wildlife sanctuary. Now this cattle are referred to the mini Kaziranga for smaller features of their nutritious food, right? So you must understand. So that is related to the news which is occurring related to the basically mini Kaziranga. So mini Kaziranga is, you must understand, is related to the nutritious food, related to the nutritious food, which is where the cattle is basically, robbing one horn rhinos, because the rhinos population was higher in the Pabi Tora wildlife sanctuary. Now, because of this nutritious food, the cattle are also venturing into this Pabi Tora wildlife sanctuary. The Pabi Tora wildlife sanctuary is situated on the floodplains of River Brahmaputra in the Assam, right? In the district of Morigaon, which is around 45 kilometers from the Guwahati, which is the capital of Assam, Now, in 1987, the Pabi Tora was declared as a wildlife sanctuary. Now it is known for the highest density of rhinoceros in the world. So the Pabi Tora wildlife sanctuary is known for the highest density of the rhinoceros in the world and second highest concentration of the rhinoceros in the Assam after Kaziranga National Park, right? So you must understand the highest density means the number of animals per unit area. The number of animals per unit area is the highest in Pabi Tora wildlife sanctuary. But if you talk about the concentration of the rhinoceros, which is the highest in Kaziranga National Park, and the second one is basically Pabi Tora Wildlife Sanctuary. All right. Now, this is also an important bird area and the home for more than 2,000 migratory birds and various reptiles. Right. So this area is also known for this. So this is basically you can read out. This is a postcard. Okay. Next is the UN Population Award for 2020. Okay, so let's understand the UN Population Award for 2020. Okay, now the UN Population Award for 2020, which is our institutional category, have now been released, right? Have now been presented to the HelpAge India, right? The HelpAge India is basically, you must understand, was presented the United Nations Population Award for 2020. right? Now, regarding UN Population Award, let's understand briefly about what is this UN Population Award for 2020 itself. Okay, so this award was established by United Nations General Assembly in 1981. Okay, this United Nations Population Award recognized the contribution in the field of population and reproductive health. So regarding contribution in terms of regarding the control of the population, okay, it has been recognizing the effort which was put behind some organizations in controlling the population. The Committee for United Nations Population Award, which made the selections, right, which is chaired by Ion Jinga, right? This Ion Jinga was the permanent representative of Romania to the United Nations. And it also consists of the representative of 9 other United Nations member state. So what did you understand from this United Nations Award for 2020? This award was given to the HelpAge India, which have tremendously contributed to in the field of population and the reproductive health. And it has been awarded, or it has been established by United Nations General Assembly, and it has been awarded to the HelpAge India. And this committee, which basically finalized the award or United Nations Population Award, which was made the selections and which is chaired by Ion Jinga, which is the permanent representative of Romania in the United Nations, right? So for the first time in the history of United Nations Population Award, the honor is being given to the Indian institution. So this is again the thing which should be proud, right? So the Indian institution have been awarded this UN Population Award in the first time in the history, right? Okay, regarding the HelpAge India, this HelpAge India is working for the cause and the care of disadvantaged older person to improve their quality of the life over 4 decades. Okay, so this HelpAge India is basically working on the disadvantaged persons or disadvantaged older person to improve the quality of the life for over 4 decades, right? And this is the HelpAge India is one such institution to receive such award from United Nations Population Award, okay, from United Nations, right? The last time the award was given to Indian was 20 years ago, which was in 1992, and it was awarded to Mr. G.R.D. Tata as an individual laureate, right? So G.R.D. Tata was awarded as the award of United Nations Population Award as an individual laureate. Otherwise, this award was granted after 28 years. And this has been awarded to the Indian institution, which is also called the HelpAge India. This HelpAge India is popularly working for almost 4 decades, right? Which is basically working for the upliftment and the care of disadvantaged older persons to improve the quality of their life, right? Isn't it? So this is the today's news. All right, dear. So we will meet again tomorrow for 24 December news. So thank you very much for those who attend this session. Thank you very much.